Heavenly Father, we just thank you for what a privilege it is to have your word. Thank you that it's available to us and it's in a language that we know and understand. And thank you for all the years that you preserved your word for your people. And thank you that your word is continuing to be translated into different languages and everything. And I pray that as we open your word tonight, that we would just understand what a privilege this is and that you would open our hearts and ears to what you have in store for us. I pray that you would speak to Pastor Mike and thank you for all the work that he's put into it. And I pray that your spirit will work in our hearts and mold us into Jesus through your word. Yes, call us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks. Okay, we're not going to start with those notes. We're going to finish last week's notes.
Yeah.
So, Pam, would you mind reading for us the first 12 verses of chapter 5?
Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the Father, loves Gabriel, has been born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Hello?
Hi. Are you looking at
the address?
You can bring it in here.
Looks like it.
Where was I?
Is this last name on you?
Is what?
Is his last name on you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. He's not answering the door.
Oh boy.
He's probably asleep.
Here's my.
Do you have a key?
Excuse me,
Oh.
class. Excuse me.
I'm sorry. We could just leave it
No,
here.
come here and get the key.
And you may have to go in the bedroom.
Okay, it's fine.
To the bedroom door and knock.
Okay.
Knock on it. Knock loud.
Okay.
And just walk in if he doesn't answer.
Okay.
Okay. I don't remember exactly where I was.
This is verse five.
Yeah, verse five. Okay. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by the water only, but by the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God, that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has a son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life.
Okay, thank you very much. So we started this, we got through verse 6. Thank you. Let me just quickly go over in this section, verses 6 through 12, Paul's picking up from the emphasis in the previous verses, 1 through 5, on proper belief in Jesus. These verses 6 through 12 emphasize the strong testimonies and witnesses that support that belief. So we've got the belief stated in the first five verses, verses 6 to 12 offer testimonies, strong testimonies and witnesses that support that belief. The Greek words testify and testimony occur 10 times in these seven verses. In verse 6, John wrote that Jesus Christ came by water and blood. And we talked about last week that the water refers to his baptism. The blood refers to his death. So taken together, these first two witnesses, the water and the blood, frame Jesus's public ministry. His public ministry began after his John's baptism of him, and his public earthly ministry ended at his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. Okay, so those are the first two witnesses. And we noted that by that phrase, not just water, but by blood, that John is emphasizing Jesus's death. And this is probably because of the false teachers, that they rejected the truth, that the Son of God took human nature to himself. They rejected the incarnation. Okay. And we talked about Cerinthus. We don't need to go back over Cerinthus. You can listen to last week's recording for that. And that he might have been a very famous opponent of John at this time. John then states that it is the Spirit that testifies to these truths. John and the other apostles were eyewitnesses to these things. That's the way the letter started, by stressing that they were chosen, authorized eyewitnesses, charged with spreading the gospel. But John's point in saying this is that the witness to these truths does not rest on the apostles alone. More importantly, it's the Spirit that testifies to them. And remember in John, 16, 8 through 11 or something like that, it's the Spirit that convicts people of sin, righteousness, and judgment. It's the Spirit that offers testimony that Jesus is the incarnate Son of God. Starting up with verse 3, John presented three witnesses. And these witnesses are the Spirit, the water, and the blood. Now, the multiple witnesses was required in Old Testament law. And this is probably why John is calling out three witnesses. And so, Nick, would you read Deuteronomy 19:15?
The chapter of my apps, but not the Bible.
No, sorry.
That's okay. So the Deuteronomy
chapter 19,
okay,
and verse 15.
A single witness shall not suffice against a person for any crime or for any wrong in connection with any offense that he has committed. Only on the evidence of two witnesses or three witnesses shall a charge be established.
Okay. Donna, would you like to read Matthew 18:16?
18:16. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses.
Okay, this is the church discipline problem. Process is what I mean. If the one-on-one doesn't work, then you go get a couple of more.
Mm-hmm.
And their function in that process is that they are witnessing the discussion between the two so that all the facts of that discussion will be established by multiple witnesses. Does that make sense? And then, Dana, would you like to read 2 Corinthians 13:1, please?
This is the third time I'm coming to you. Every charge must be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses.
Okay, and so again, this is Paul carrying out Matthew 18:16, which is probably founded on Deuteronomy 19:5, the law's requirement for multiple witnesses. So that's what John's doing. He's deducing three witnesses, the water, the blood, and the spirit. And these represent the earthly ministry of Jesus, its beginning and conclusion, and the present work of the Spirit. And these three agree in their testimony. So these are the witnesses that John is calling to support the apostolic proclamation about the person and work of Christ. He's appealing to greater witnesses, the historical fact of, and accomplishments of Jesus in his public ministry, his baptism and his death, and the present work of the Spirit. Okay? That's supporting what the apostles are proclaiming about Christ. All right, so then in verse 9, John urged belief in the apostolic view of Jesus with an argument from the lesser to the greater. You see, he said, if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. So that's why he laid down those three witnesses: Jesus's earthly ministry, and which is the first two witnesses, and the present work of the Spirit. And this is what the Father testifies regarding the Son as well. So he's saying, look, you, if in a human court, in a human situation, you accept, well, we used to, nowadays you're kind of crazy, but we used to accept that facts being established or confirmed by multiple witnesses. He says, you do that when the testimony is just from mere humans. How much more then should we accept the testimony of God himself? And so obviously, the secessionists, those that left the church, they're rejecting God's testimony. That's going to be John's next point. So in verse 10, John presented only two possible responses to this testimony. The testimony being the historical fact of Jesus's public ministry, what he came and did, and the present work of the Spirit testifying to that. There's only two possible responses to that testimony: belief or unbelief. It's that simple. Believing the message results in being born of God and being indwelt by the Spirit, and therefore having the witness in yourself. Let's do that in verse 10. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar. But whoever believes the testimony of God has the testimony in themselves. So to believe God's testimony results in being born of God and being indwelt by the Spirit, and therefore having the witness in oneself. On the other hand, the one who does not believe God has made him a liar. That's the second half of verse 10. And what we need to understand is this is not a harsh exaggeration on John's part. You know, people might say, oh, that's hard. But it's not a harsh exaggeration. God has given testimony about the person and identity of Jesus Christ. And that testimony has been confirmed by the historical ministry of Jesus, the apostolic witness, and the testimony of the Spirit. So that John's point is there can be no neutrality, and the consequences are eternal. Okay. And so then in verse 11, he draws out the implication of those last two verses. He says, and this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. This is the implication of the testimony that God has given us life in his Son. That's the gospel. That's what the testimony about the person and work of Christ, historically, and the ongoing work of the Spirit, convicting people of that. The implication of that is we have eternal life in him. That's the point of proclaiming this message. So God has borne clear witness to the person and work of Jesus, points to God's gift of eternal life in his Son. That's what he's saying. And then verse 12 concludes that eternal life is found only in the Son. So to have the Son is to have eternal life. To not have the Son is to not have eternal life. To have the Son is to believe in him. And remember, this is chapter 5. John knows he's landing the plane in this chapter. And so you can look at these first 12 verses as John just presenting, summing up his case that he's made regarding Christ and the consequences of either believing God's testimony about Christ or rejecting it. He's summing that up. And he's presenting it very clearly. And he makes the case. You've got three witnesses. The historical public ministry of Christ and the ongoing testimony of the Spirit. You accept confirmation of facts when two or three witnesses, when they're just mere humans. This is God giving this testimony about Christ. And the stakes are high. Now, he's doing that in these first 12 verses. He's summing up that case because in verses 13 through 21, he's going to follow with five assurances and the final call, the final charge. So he's presenting the gospel clearly. He's presenting the apostolic message clearly and presenting the witnesses and emphasizing the significance of the testimony that we have regarding Christ and showing us the stakes that are involved in how we respond to that testimony. Then in verse 13, he turns to these believers. Well, he was addressing them in first 12 verses, but then in verse 13, to completely land the plane, he's going to leave these believers with five assurances because they believe the testimony of God. Mm-hmm. And so he's leaving them with these five assurances. And when we go through these assurances, we're going to see that in verses 13 to 20, we're going to see in those eight verses that these five assurances are assurances that he's already given throughout the book, throughout the letters. He's just chapter 5, he's landing the plane. He's summing everything up, presents the historical case for Christ in those first 12 verses, showing how the false teachers are clearly rejecting testimony from God and the significance of that. And then he's assuring these believers in just rapid fire succession. He throws out these five assurances, and that's your next set of notes here. Verses 13 through 21. So, Julie, would you like to read verses 13 through 21 for us?
I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother commit a sin, not leading to death, he shall ask, and God will give him life. To those who commit sin that do not lead to death, there is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are from God, and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. He is the true God, eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols.
Okay. All righty. So, in the notes, I say the opening verse, verse 13 of this section, connects the belief or faith of the previous section, verses 1 through 12, to assurance. And that is the theme of this closing section. You see in verse 13 where he says, I write these things to you. That phrase, these things, refers back to the previous section. And he says, I write these things to you that you may know. This phrase, we know, is in this section is used repeatedly to point out those assurances. Notice in the parentheses there, I give you the five occurrences of it. Five occurrences in those eight verses, 13 through 20. So he closes with these several assurances to help his dear readers persevere. And that's the key thing there, for them to hold on, persevere. Okay, so let's start this. John gives his readers five assurances and a final charge in these nine verses. The final charge is in the ninth verse. Okay, first of all, verse 13. He says, I write these things to you, believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. So this first assurance is assurance of eternal life. He writes that his purpose in writing is to give assurance of eternal life to those who believe in the name of the Son of God. In the previous section, he explained that possession of such life depends on believing the full truth about who Jesus is. So that's why he says, I write these things that you may know that you have eternal life. His entire letter has been concerned to help his readers hold on to that truth, that apostolic truth, and know that they have eternal life. So that's the first assurance. Like I said, he's just going through here in rapid fire succession, verses 13 through 20, giving five assurances. So then verses 14 through 17, this will take a little bit more time than the others. Assurance of answered prayer. And again, we've seen that assurance given. It was in chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Assurance of eternal life leads to confidence in prayer. This is essentially the same point that John made back in chapter 3, 21 through 22. There, it was a clear conscience that leads to confidence in prayer. But the reason the forgiveness of sins, the clearing of your conscience, was possible is because you have eternal life. You've already been forgiven, and your conscience was guilty before God because you are a born one and you chafe, you grieve at your sin. And back there, he was saying, God knows our obedience is imperfect. Mm-hmm. And so when your conscience accuses you before God, remember, God is greater than your conscience. And he knows all things, meaning he knows all about you and what's going on in your life and what has done and is doing in your life. Here, the confidence is because you have eternal life. So you can see how those two things are related. And this is the confidence that we have before. If we ask, anybody remember this from this morning? I did the catechism on. This is right where I got it. The confidence that we have before him is if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Notice he doesn't say he gives us what we ask. He doesn't say that yet. He doesn't say that in this verse. So it's a two-step process here. First, in verse 13, he says, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Mm-hmm. And that's significant. Great God, the living God, hears us. And this refers to a favorable hearing. That is, he pays attention to what we're saying with the intent to answer. So this is a favorable hearing. You pray according to his will, he hears you favorably and delights to answer. So the prayer, but here's the condition. The prayer he hears this way is the one that is according to his will. And I remember this morning, I was saying that causes us trouble. Because for the most part, we don't know God's will. There's a lot that happens. And the vast preponderance, we don't know until it happens. When John says, if we pray according to his will, he hears us, what position does that put us in? Are we supposed to try to discover his secret will, his unrevealed will? No. Let's see, who are we up to? I think you want to read Deuteronomy 29:29, please.
The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but the things that are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law.
Okay, notice that. What God has revealed to us, the things that he has revealed to us are ours. And their purpose, the purpose that God revealed these things to us, is so that we would obey him all the days of our life. But everything else that he has not revealed, those are the secret things, and they belong to the Lord. That's why, you can read, I think it's in chapter 18 of Deuteronomy, where he goes through, now I'm blanking on the word, a person false prophecy, or a necromancer, or a medium, that's the word I was trying, a medium. All of those things are efforts to discover secret, hidden things that God has not revealed. And he's, I believe it's the entire chapter of 18, or an awful lot of that. He goes through that. There's severe consequences for
the entire chapter of what?
Deuteronomy 18.
Or Deuteronomy 1.
John isn't saying that we need to discover those secret hidden things, the unrevealed will of God, in order to pray according to his will. What his point is that we should ask according to what the Bible teaches about God's will for his people. We call that his revealed will. God's revelation, the Bible, acts as bumpers or guardrails that keep us aligned with his will. So In verse 15, that was verse 14, and then in verse 15, John says that if God hears us in this way, we have the requests that we have asked of him. That's quite the promise. And the picture here that John is painting for us is God is a loving father who is attentive to our needs and concerns, and he delights to answer us when we pour out those needs, concerns, and requests to him. But like I was saying this morning, this passage is very much abused. It has been for a long time. And there's a lot of things that we could ask that in general is aligned with his will, his revealed will for people. But that doesn't mean that he's going to answer that prayer in the way that we want it answered, in the way that we anticipate it. So, for instance, praying for the healing of a loved one. God may answer it, I'm not going to heal them. I'm going to take them to myself. That doesn't violate this promise. That doesn't gut this promise. What we have to remember is because God loves us, he screens our requests through the filter of his knowledge of what is best for us. He's aware of everything. He's wise. But yeah.
That kind of goes to what Wes was talking about today, about being put in circumstances or situations repeatedly. You know, so you are
a point
until you get the point.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So this kind of
accept that until you get the point. You haven't been asking
you for it. You haven't been
kind of fighting against as well.
I guess they kind of they go against you. They
go hand in hand.
Yeah.
And I mean they're a match set in that this gives you the other way to respond.
Right. Yeah.
So you think about it. We are in our prayers, we're pouring out our heart. Because we trust him, we entrust ourselves implicitly to his care. So we pour out our heart about our needs and concerns and requests regarding those. And we find him to be a refuge, a mighty fortress, like what we sang about this morning. That's the three parts. Psalm 62:8. Trust in the Lord, pour your heart out to him. Our God is a strong refuge. That's the way those three parts of that verse fit together. And we are to pray with a humble attitude. That is, we humbly submit to his will. We soak ourselves in scripture. We're trying to let scripture act as guardrails to align us with God's will. But within that will, there can be several different answers that God gives us. And so we humbly submit ourselves to his will, knowing that what God is doing is that he is screening our requests based on his knowledge of what's best for us. And I really said that if we could see God's perspective in the way that he answers our prayer, that's exactly what we want to pray for. Because he knows best. Um, So, any question about those two verses and that poems?
If we knew what God's secret will is, we wouldn't want it. You know?
I mean, like, we wouldn't want to have all that knowledge?
Some of that too, but it's just seeing what God does.
Oh,
you know,
oh, yeah.
And how he.
Yeah. Everything that he's
answered,
yeah.
Everything he's doing, we want it. Mm-hmm. So it's probably, it's our protection for us that we don't know what he's going to do.
Yeah. You think of all the things that have happened that hit us as horrifying. We don't want to know all the other things. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Well, verses 16 and 17 is a specific example of that praying. Verses 14 and 15 tell us we can go boldly before God, pour our hearts out to him with confidence, because we're born ones. We're his adopted children. He's given us eternal life, and he wants that relationship with him, and we can boldly approach him with these requests as we're allowing scripture to align us with his will. And so John brings up a specific example of how we should be praying, and that is praying for a sinning brother, specifically praying for the perseverance of one another. Why do you suppose he brought up this specific example to them?
I think mainly because of what was going on during that time when there was a separation between what people were being, or what people were teaching, and what people knew what was right. So there was this, like we discussed earlier in this, that there were like this animosity or this, this hate for.
So it's very, very fresh in their experience that there's a whole segment of the church that were teaching and believing aberrant views about Christ and his work, and they left the church. So it's not at all surprising that this is the specific example that he brings up. Praying for a sinning brother, praying for the perseverance of one another.
You might get to it later, so never mind.
Okay. John says that if a believer sees his brother fall into sin, he should ask that God would give him life. Now, it may seem strange. You might think, if he's a brother, he's already got life. What he means by this is that God would preserve this sinning brother in the faith. Okay. I mean, there's other things that we can pray for with that brother. His battle against that sin, against those temptations, there's many things. But what John is zeroing in on is praying that God would preserve this sinning brother or sister in the faith. And so we need to drill down on that. Notice though the wording that he uses. He says in verses 16, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin not leading to death, he shall ask and God will give him life. To those who commit sins that do not lead to death. Notice how he just emphasized that. There is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death. So we're left with questions, with these questions. What is the distinction between sin not leading to death and sin that leads to death? What's the distinction there? And why does John say to pray for the former one, the one sinning, committing sin that does not lead to death, but he does not say to pray for the latter, the one that's committing a sin that leads to death? Why does he say it the way that he says it? The one that's committing a sin not leading to death, pray for him. The one that's committing a sin that leads to death, committing sin that leads to death, I don't say pray for him. Why does he say it this way? And what's the distinction between sin that leads, that does not lead to death, and sin that does lead to death? And so that's what that second paragraph there tries to deal with. I think, I'm certain, I'm convinced that John has two different groups of professing Christians in mind. So I'm emphasizing the word professing. That's why it's italicized. The one he says to pray for is a genuine, born one of God. Pray for that one. How do we know that the one that's committing sin that does not lead to death, how do we know that that is a genuine born one of God? And when I say that, when I ask that question, how do we know? I'm referring to the text. What are we seeing in the text that would lead us to think that one is a genuine believer, born of God?
His brother.
Yep.
Yeah.
He's called a brother. So a fellow believer. And then secondly, he is committing the very phrase there. He's committing a sin not leading to death. What's the basic thing that we as believers know about sin?
Christ died for our sins. He paid yes. the
penalty. And why did he die? Because all sin leads to death.
Mm-hmm.
So what is John talking about here? Sin that does not lead to death. All sin leads to death. Anybody quote Romans 6:23? Romans wrote. Dropping the needle here. Say that again.
For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Yes, excellent. So the wages of sin is death. All sin leads to death. So those are the two clues. He calls this one a brother and says that he's committing a sin that does not lead to death. We know all sin leads to death. So why doesn't that sin that person's committing lead to death? You?
Because they're in Christ.
They're in Christ. Yes, your previous answer. There, Christ died for it. All sin leads to death except for Christ's people. In their case, Christ died for their sins so that their sins are forgiven and they live eternally. So the one who's the first one is a fellow believer that's whose sins have already been forgiven. God has been propitiated. He's been satisfied. His wrath has been satisfied on that person's sin in the person of Christ. And that's the only case that we can have when you talk about sin, where sin does not lead to death. Remember,
we
James.
Don't always know. Some profess, and we don't know.
Precisely. And yes, exactly. And that's why I said he has two different groups of professing Christians and emphasize the word professing. This first group are genuine. They profess to be believers, and they genuinely are. The second group profess to be people of God, and they are not. And that's why their sin leads to death. So the other group are those who profess Christ that make it obvious that they are not part of Christ's people. Where are we up to? 1 John chapter 2, verses 18 and 19.
Children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they are all not of us.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much. That was excellent. So notice he said there in this verse 19, they went out from us that it may be plain that they weren't of us. So it's an obvious thing. And remember, throughout the letter, John has given us tests how you can tell whether a person is in Christ or not. He says the brother that rejects the incarnation, that does not love others, and do not obey God, they are of the Antichrist, and they are false brethren. They do not belong to Christ. And those very things, they're persisting in their unbelief regarding the incarnation of the Son of God, their persistence in their disobedience to loving one another and obeying all the rest of God's commands, their persistence in all of that is their sinning that leads to death. Okay. It indicates a lack of saving faith. And it is a lack, here's the point, is a lack of saving faith that cannot be forgiven. Okay. Clearly, persisting in disbelief in not loving people, John called it hating brothers, and persisting in disobedience is not why a person cannot be forgiven. Because every single one of us have persisted in that. But we were brought to see that the Son of God indeed took a human flesh and blood nature to himself, went to the cross, died for our sins. The Spirit convicted us of that. He brought us to saving faith. And our sins were forgiven. We were changed from haters of God to lovers of God, although imperfect lovers of God. At the very base of our heart and will, we desire to obey him. In other words, once we were brought to faith, once the Spirit produced spiritual life to us and brought us to faith, we began fighting sin. Not before. We were persistent in those same things that these believers that left the church were persisting in. Because we were saved, because Christ rescued us out of this darkness, the Holy Spirit gave us saving faith. That is why we're forgiven. To lack saving faith is something that cannot be forgiven. That's not saying that the faith saves us. Strictly speaking, it does not. It's Christ that saves us, but it's our faith that connects us to him. And so without it, a person cannot be forgiven. No. Well, let me just go through this third paragraph and then I'll let you answer.
No,
ask
you answer it.
Oh, okay.
You answer it with cool. What that thing was.
So that's the distinction between the one who commits a sin not leading to death and the one who commits a sin that leads to death. Now, what about the question of why he tells us, why he says, I do not say, pray for the one that's committing sin that leads to death. Why does he say it? And why does he say it like that? Notice John did not forbid praying for a brother, so-called brother, one professing to be a Christian. He did not forbid praying for that brother that commits sin that leads to death. What he's doing here is he leaves the open whether to pray for that situation when it arises. He does not say, do not pray for them. Those times, those situations have happened. Remember in Jeremiah, God told Jeremiah the prophet, stop praying for Judah and Jerusalem. Stop praying for them because I'm going to judge them. But that's not what John does here. What John is doing, here's the thing I want us to understand. What John's doing is he is zeroing in on genuine believers persevering in the faith. And he's saying this is one of the things that we should be praying for one another. This is what is the will of God. It's revealed. It's the revealed will of God that we persevere and that we pray so that in our prayers, we ask God, help that brother persevere. Keep him from making shipwreck of his faith. So that's the point here. And so when he says, I do not say, pray for the one that's committing a sin that leads to death, he's saying, that's not the situation I'm talking about. I'm talking about the brother who's being challenged and doubting, or whatever it is, the situation that they're in. I'm saying, pray for that brother, that God preserves his preserves him in the faith, that God gives him life, preserves him in the faith. So he leaves open whether to pray for that situation that arises. And so we're going to close with this. So I think the takeaway here should be this regarding the unbeliever, that we can, or the person who claims, I guess, to be more accurate here, the person that claims to be a believer but fights against the historic apostolic faith regarding Christ and the gospel, we can pray for their repentance, but we have permission to stop when it seems appropriate. Now, don't ask me what that would look like. If it seems appropriate, I don't know. But we've got permission to stop praying for them. But I think the implication is we should be praying. And so let's, I guess we're up to you. You want to close us just by reading 2 Timothy 2, 24 through 26?
And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, after being captured by him to do his will.
Okay, that's how we should pray regarding the believer that's sinning, committing a sin that leads to death. A professing believer, one who professes to believe, to be a believer, but is committing sin that leads to death. We see how Paul, what Paul's attitude is toward them and how he would pray for them. In 1 Timothy 2, Paul's addressing that specific case. In 1 John 5, John's not addressing that specific case. Okay. So Pam, you want to close us in prayer? And then I'll shut it off.
Father, we thank you for the privilege that you're giving to us to come before you and pray. And we thank you for giving us this teaching tonight about what we should be praying for and what we should leave in your hands. And we thank you for the opportunity to be together tonight and ask that you would keep us all safe in you this week. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.